check, and it seems like you guys are ready to go. You're like, I can't wait to hear Commissioner Farrow's remarks. So I just want to give you a brief welcome. My name is Paul Danchek. I'm the Director of Executive Education in Sacramento for the University of Southern California. For those of you that have been here before, you'll be familiar with our mission, which is really threefold. Certainly the academic programs. We offer a Master of Public Administration program here in Sacramento, taught on the intensive format, really geared towards working professionals. So if you're interested in learning more about the MPA, or know someone in your office or in your networks that might be interested, there's a flyer for an upcoming information session on August 22nd. And Doug, if you could raise your hand, Doug is our new Director of Outreach and Marketing. So you'll see his friendly face more often around the center. This is his first week, so let's give Doug a welcome. Yeah. Our second main mission is policy outreach, connecting faculty members with the policymaking community in Sacramento. We're fortunate to have four in-house faculty members, but we also bring up experts from Los Angeles to interact with the Sacramento community. And the third is my bailiwick, and that's executive education programs really geared at leadership and management topics at the public and nonprofit sectors. And that's how I met Becca and Apsi about 2 years ago, working on the big symposium in 2011. No, 2012.
We started in 11.
And it's hard to believe that it's been almost 2 years now since we've been working together and really tackling this type of question of how do we bring transformational leadership to our offices and thinking about it at all levels within government and certainly the state level being part of that. It's been a great partnership of working with APSI and with Becca on these challenges, and my role is to introduce Becca. So please help me welcome Becca Christensen, who you all know, love, and adore. Becca.
Thank you, Paul. I want to welcome all of you here to our third of our four-part series of Navigating Leadership, Conversations in Leadership. And I think it's really important, a lot of us, when we did the event, about the one and only criticism we had is that there wasn't enough communication. And so these events have been designed to specifically address that. And Commissioner Farrell will be talking with us tonight for approximately 50% of the time. And then, as we have done in the past, we will have interactive discussion with the audience. And I'm pleased to say that the continuum of our relationship with USC is moving forward, and we have begun working on our 2014 event. I turn it over to Jeff Uwida to introduce the commissioner tonight. There was a quote that came to mind, and it was Norman Schwarzkopf quote, and it was, "Leadership is a combination of strategy and character. If you must be without one, be without strategy." This really resonated with me as I have gotten to know the commissioner. And as you listen to him tonight, I really want you to look at the character of the man who stands before you, because character is who we are in the world, not what we do. And as you see and hear the strength of the character of this esteemed gentleman that will be before you shortly, I want it to serve as a point of reflection back to you. I want you to see what he has to say as it relates to your life and allow you to reflect on the character of who you are personally and who you are in leadership. And with that, I want to turn it over to Jeff, and Jeff will introduce the commissioner.
Thank you, Rebecca. First, I'd like to say a little bit, I had the honor of serving under the command of Commissioner Farrow, and it was a very high point, and one of the high points of my career, and enjoyed that very much, and enjoyed his leadership throughout the years that I was there. The California Highway Patrol is one of the nation's largest law enforcement agencies. On March 2008, then-Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger appointed Joseph A. Farrow Commissioner of the CHP. And he was reappointed by Governor Jerry Brown in 2011. With a department of more than 12,000 personnel, Commissioner Farrell commands the fifth largest law enforcement agency in the nation. Commissioner Farrell entered the CHP Academy in 1979, and throughout his career has quickly promoted through the ranks. He is the first Japanese-American CHP commissioner. Commissioner Farrell has demonstrated his commitment to higher learning by earning executive level certificates, graduating from several schools of learning to include his master's degree in executive leadership from San Diego State University. Commissioner Farrow has been recognized and endorsed for his innovative leadership approach in public administration. He was selected by the International Association of Chiefs of Police, IACP, as a recipient of the 2006 J. Stannard Baker Award for his sustained career-spanning and extraordinary initiative and creativity in developing, implementing, and improving traffic safety programs and technologies within the state of California, and for his willingness to promote nationally and internationally significant traffic safety issues. He is a member of the IACP, the California Peace Officers Association, the National Asian Peace Officers Association. Without further ado, I'd like to welcome Commissioner Joseph A. Farrow.
Well, good evening, everyone, and thank you very much for the invitation to be here. I'm deeply honored. I've been anticipating this night for a very, very long time. Almost didn't make it. I came in from Louisville, Kentucky, just a couple hours ago. I was back dealing with the IACP, dealing with some issues and had some plane troubles, but I made it. And, but I wasn't here. I'm sure Jeff could have filled in admirably. he would have done an outstanding job. But, hopefully, the sound of my voice will carry for everybody here. Tonight's going to be very informal. You're probably looking at, I'll call it a syllabus, that's not what it was meant to be, it was just meant to be a little bit of an outline. You probably can't make any sense out of my little boxes that I have there, but tonight is going to be about the way my dad raised me, things that my dad taught me to be true, his philosophy of life, his philosophy of leadership, the way he thought that his children should conduct themselves, both as children and to be successful adults in whatever endeavor they wanted to do. I'll tell you a little bit about myself. I'll tell you why I chose to come on the High Up Trail. We'll talk a little bit about what the High Up Trail is and what it is not. And then I'll get into my 18 lessons of leadership. Some of them are very basic and very simple, but I try to share a little story with you at each one, and you can see how I was taught as a young child to remember the lessons that my dad tried to teach me. These same lessons are the ones that I use when I teach classes at the High Up Trail Academy, when I teach new young recruits, or people who are in positions of leadership, all the way up to my command staff that I have within my organization. For me, I grew up and born and raised for my first 6 years of life in Tokyo, Japan. Moved to the United States in 1964, moved to Monterey, Pebble Beach, California, where my dad was in the military and he raised his family there. When I was in the fourth grade, I accepted a position as the school safety board guy, you know, the guy that held up the little sign. You walk across the street and the kids get to walk across, and I was promoted to captain. There were only four of us at the time, and I was the captain. And it was probably my first position of leadership. At the end of the year, the California Highway Patrol hosted the four members from my squad, plus the surrounding four elementary schools, for a total of 16 of us, and we went to the Highway Patrol office in Monterey, and we had a tour. Each of the kids at that time were asked to have at least one question for the tour guide, and we would go from there. I kind of forgot, and I didn't really know what to ask, so the simplest thing that came to mind at the time was there was a picture as we were walking down the hallway, and I said, "Who is that?" And he says, "Well, that's the commissioner of the California Highway Patrol." I said, "And that is," he said, "that's the guy that runs the entire organization. That's the number one guy on the Highway Patrol." I thought that was pretty neat. Got to see the picture of the commissioner. 4 weeks later, fourth grade, sits down. We're learning how to do cursive writing. And the question of the day was, "What do you want to be when you grow up? What do you want to do when you grow up?" That was the question. And we had to write it in block form in about 7 or 8 lines. And I thought, gosh, I'll be the commissioner of the California Highway Patrol. That sounded pretty good at the time, so I wrote an essay. Wow. Said that I would like to be the commissioner of the California Highway Patrol. That would be my dream. I just think that would be a cool job. And a misspelled commissioner, got a big red mark across the I know there was two S's in there, but I did my best. And and I filed that away. And so grew up in Monterey. I tried to join the Hive Patrol as I was approaching my 20s. They weren't hiring at the time. I got a job with the Pacifico Police Department, the city in which I lived. I worked there for a couple of years. The Hive Patrol then tested after that, took the examination, and came onto the Hive Patrol. So when you hear the term Highway Patrol, for the most part, I'll tell you what, for most of you, I'm looking around the room. I think most of you remember television the way I do. And there was a series that was on TV many years ago. It's not truly reflective of what the Highway Patrol does, but it was entertaining. I actually thought it was a good job. I used to show. I would watch that at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. It would come on. And then right after that, Dragnet came on with Jack Webb. Remember that?
Yeah.
And then Adam 12. And I'd watch all three of them. And I just thought they were really good. But there was something about the Hive Patrol that just kept drawing me back. It was always about the Hive Patrol. It was something that I really got interested in. Well, forget all the things that you remember about Chips, because we didn't do any of that. And we didn't do any of that. And I was going to show you just a real quick commercial clip on who the Hive Patrol is. Difficult task of getting me ready to speak here today, so I asked her to put something together about the Hive Patrol. What that was 4 PSAs that we used to recruit, and we just stuck them together so you can kind of get a general idea of what we do. So a little bit about the Hive Patrol. You heard in the opening comments, we're an organization of just under 12,000 people with an operating budget of $2.1 billion. We cost us about $6 million a day to operate the Hive Patrol. We are a statewide law enforcement organization that runs from border to border, ocean to Nevada to Arizona. Our primary mission is the movement of people, property, and goods across the nation of the state's highway system and all unincorporated areas within California. Our secondary mission is to assist any agency, any allied agency, county sheriffs, or police departments in the performance of their jobs when necessary. Also, the responsibility for all state facilities, all state employees, the aqueduct, the waterways, the power grids, the power plants, and search and rescue air missions with our 30 aircraft. I have a fleet of about 3,200 patrol cars, consume about 6.5 million gallons of fuel per year, go through 225,000 tires, you know, that go from there and stuff. And I employ about just under 9,000 officers who actually go out and work the beat. We were formed in 1929, really for the sole purpose at that time for the legislature to standardize and enforce the motor laws in California. You have to remember in 1929, the motor vehicles was just getting into operation, and one of the jobs that we had to do was work very closely with the DMV and the Hive Patrol to standardize the way people would drive their automobiles. Because back then, from county to county, you had different jurisdictions, different rules, different speed limits, different signs, and nothing was standard. And the legislature at the time thought that they needed one agency that would be responsible for traffic movement, and that's why the patrol was created back in 1929. And so that's a little bit of our department. I'll leave that open for any questions that you may have as we go through. But really, what I'm here to do to talk to you about is leadership. and what leadership means to me, and how I was taught leadership, and how we try to share that with the employees that we have, and go from there. The handouts that you have, they're very simple. They were given to you in case you want to take a couple of notes. But I'll go through them the way that my dad used to tell me. The first one is right there in front of you. It sounds kind of dumb. You'll see it. You don't know what you don't know. And I can tell you for me, and probably for all of you, running an agency with 12,000 people, there are so many moving parts. There are so many things that go within on our day-to-day basis within the high-up chart. You can't possibly know everything. And I think the most important thing for me is what my dad always tried to tell me is, no matter how you try, no matter where you go to school, and no matter who you surround yourself with, you will never know everything that you need to know to be successful. You will never know everything that is going on within your organization. Therefore, it's extremely important for you as you get into positions of leadership, positions of management, eventually becoming the CEO of a big organization. You have to surround yourself with people who are there for you, work with you, are in tune to what is going on in the organization, and your communication that you have with one another has to be constant, and it has to be meaningful at all times. For us, where I've always thought that once I got into a position like this, somehow you magically know everything about your organization. you truly don't. You really don't know that. And I think what's important for us when we train our managers, when we train our chiefs and our commanders and stuff, is to instill in that same belief that they don't ever know everything, that they always need to be inquisitive. In fact, we have a saying that we use in our sergeant school, our lieutenant school, is never underestimate the inquisitive mind of our leadership. And as long as they're asking questions and as long as they are searching for the right answers and to know what really is going on within their discipline, then the organization will be kind of successful. But I don't think anybody ever has every single answer out there, and nor should you be expected to do that, but I think you need to know that. My lesson two is, there it is. You can probably try to find out what that is. It's in your book. It came from a book called Flight of the Buffalo. Those are supposed to be buffalo. They're running up here. And the buffalo are kind of running over the cliff right here. Buffalo are probably the most loyal animal probably on the face of the earth. They're very loyal to the herd. They're very loyal to the buffalo that has dominance over the herd through many series of fights. One buffalo will emerge as the leader of the pack. I mean, that's just animal instincts. That's what occurs. The entire herd will follow the leader. They follow the leader wherever they go. When the lead buffalo stops to eat, the rest will graze. When it moves, the herd will move with it. Very, very, very loyal to the herd. Back, we'll call it in the early Western civilization, probably in the 1830s to the 1850s, buffalo hunting became a sport. It was a sport that was generated by people's thrill of shooting animals at the time. And you remember back then, you know, the Indians shot buffalo for food. And in the Western civilization, the buffalo then became hunted for sport. And people used to go out to find these herds, and they would try to shoot buffalo. And what would happen, as soon as the first shot would go off, the herd would take off and they would run. Very difficult for people to shoot the herd, and they really didn't accomplish what they wanted to do. They finally figured out that if they shot the leader, if they shot the buffalo that was in the lead, the herd would stop, because the herd thought that the buffalo was stopping to rest. So the entire herd came to a stop. And then the hunters would just merely shoot and shoot and shoot, and they would kill the herd. And that's where my dad used to talk about is that's blind loyalty to the herd. And he talked about loyalty being one of the most important things that you can do in your profession, your discipline, your job, and what you do. But you have to understand there's limits to that loyalty. But there is blind loyalty that sometimes will take you into a domain that you don't want to go. But he talked about the importance of working in teams and working in groups, working together, but understanding at some point in time, you as an individual, you as a supervisor, you as a leader, you have to stop and say, wait a minute, am I part of the herd? Maybe I should stand up and say, hey, I don't know if this is the right thing to do. I'm not sure we're going in the right direction. I don't think we should be doing this, and somebody has to stand up to talk about it. Because you don't want to be blind loyalty and just run yourself off a cliff. Deep down in your mind or your heart or your subconscious, you go, I don't think we're doing the right thing. I think we need to go in a different direction. So the illustration for me was all about the herd, all about how loyal the buffalo were to the herd. But in that case, some 150 years ago, 175 years ago, buffalo almost went into extinction because of the way they were hunted and because of the way people figured out, just take out the leader and then you have a series of problems. So that's what that was called. It's about the flight of the buffalo, blind loyalty, understanding that loyalty exists in every single organization. You should expect it, you should worship it, you should want it, but you should also understand that it has limitations and sometimes you just have to step away and you have to challenge some of the assumptions that are being made. And you have to be able to debate and have some meaningful dialogue when you think the direction that people are going is wrong. And I think that's encouraged in organizations. I don't think we see it enough. I think sometimes people will become more subservient than they really should be. But I think in the true leadership era, people should be able to have the power and the will to be able to sit down and healthily debate any of the issues that may transpire within their organizations. The next one is, I like this one because when I was a young boy, you'll just see the flock of geese, and then I'll have another one come on with the peloton to race. My dad used to, when he would see a flock of geese and a flock of birds, and they'd fly in formation, they'd fly in that V formation. My dad always talked about teamwork. He always talked about that as an individual. You know, you can do a lot of things, you can accomplish a lot, but he truly believed that people working together in harmony as a team would always accomplish more than the individual. And that illustration, you see it every single day. You'll go outside, you'll watch the birds fly. Always one out front, but if you watch very, very carefully as they fly, this one will always drop back to the back of the bee, and another one will take its place. As they fly, they break the wind and they run. And they'll fly until they get tired, and the birds will start dropping back as they go along. Just like if you watched the Tour de France the other day, you see the peloton? The peloton is a perfect V of riders, all riding together. And I didn't really realize this until I really, really started to watch the Tour de France. You always see the race. Four or five of these riders will take off, and they'll start riding as fast as they can. They try to break away from the pack. Rare do they ever finish in front of the peloton. Peloton always catches them. Because they ride as a team, they break the wind. People back here are riding, they say, at 65% capacity, while the ones in front ride at 100. The ones that break away are riding at 100, they can't sustain it. There's no way they can sustain that energy to go. And the peloton always wins. And so the illustration that we would like to talk about, what we teach in our patrol academy, is the fact that we have officers who come to us as individuals. We train them as an individual and ultimately put them into a team environment where they work as a team. Everything we do are teams. We have beats where we assign multiple officers to certain jurisdictions and sections with the responsibility of reducing injury, accidents, fatalities within that area. And they work in these team concepts to be able to go out and do their job. And the part that was important for us, it was important for a young boy, was you will go out and you'll do many, many, many things. Associate yourself with something good, something that you believe in, something where you can work in harmony, something you can do as a team. And that is one of the reasons why I chose the California High School. I just thought it was an organization that had some value, had some meaning to it, and that it was an organization that had a very noticeable vision that I wanted to be part of. And the team environment within our organization is really what we're all about. So that was the teamwork philosophy that I used the field marshal's baton. This is the one that I think is probably one of the most important in any place in leadership. The best way to say this, when you go back 2,000 years ago and you work at the power, the height of the Roman Empire, I mean, nobody can argue that that was one of the most dominating empires in the history of the world. Probably at one time, 25 to 35% of the world power. One country. And when Rome would go to war, the responsibilities of war were always directed to the field marshals. Marshals who would actually go out and lead the battalions to go out and either protect Rome or to go out and to conquer new lands. And when the field marshals were victorious, they would march back into Rome, and the emperor and the Senate would be present. And in a display of public support, the emperor would bestow upon the field marshal a baton. It was about 24 inches long, a couple inches in diameter. It was laced in gold, and they called it a field marshal's baton. It was given to the field marshal who was victorious. And they believed in Rome, the person who possessed the field marshal's baton was the person who had the power to lead the legions of Rome. And when the baton went in the air, legionaries would follow, they would go out into war, and they would fight on behalf of the field marshal's baton. And that was their belief, and that's how they were structured, and that's how they would go out into war. 1,800 years later, a gentleman by the name of Napoleon. Napoleon was rising to power, and he was going out trying to do the same thing. He was trying to go out and conquer new lands, take on new territory, and really go out and conquer some countries he probably shouldn't have. But he marches to Russia, he gets there, and he realizes that he is outnumbered, he's tired, he doesn't have any food, it's the dead of winter, he's cold, and he starts for the very first time to realize that, well, I don't know if we're going to do very well. We have a superior enemy that we're about ready to fight, and he's not sure at that point what is going to happen. So he surrounds himself with the leadership and as many people as he can talk to. Keep in mind there are no microphones, there's no way that public address anything. And he brings everybody together and he says, my fellow countrymen, we have marched a long way, we are here for battle, we must be victorious for our land, we must be victorious for our families. I may not survive today, I may fall in battle, but remember that each of you carries with you a field marshal's baton, all of you. So you think about what he was telling them at that time. What he was telling them was that I may not be here, but I expect each and every one of you to symbolically raise the baton. You must absorb the leadership within our legion. You must carry this forward because if not you, then who? He believed differently from the Romans. He believed that leadership could be instilled or displayed or exercise with any level within his armies. That he had an expectation that regardless of who you were or what your rank was or what your title was, under battle and under strict rules of war, you should be able to lead and carry on. And he believed that although there wasn't a baton to give symbolically and with pride, he could bestow that upon people, which would motivate allow his people to go out and fight in these wars. That's where, if you think about it, you know, the baton, you always talk about passing on the baton and you do things with the organization. I think that's where that phrase materialized from, that's where it came. You hear that sometimes in organizations. You're holding the baton, you know, don't drop the baton, you've got it. That's what you're talking about, is that there's an expectation that each and every one of you carry that baton. And I think that's important, especially within the discipline that we have, probably all of yours. You have so many people within your organization that you train and you develop, and sometimes they wait for you to make all the decisions. They truly want you to make the decisions that they could. I think if they truly knew that they actually had the baton and had the power to make some of these decisions, it would actually be good for your organization, it would actually be good for you, and you would actually start building the leadership of tomorrow. I think a lot of times within our organizations our people don't realize that they can do this and that they actually have the power to lead the group that they have. And I think that especially in a law enforcement agency, because we're so structured, it's so military structured that if, you know, if I'm a lieutenant and you're a sergeant, the sergeant always believes the lieutenant will always be the ones giving the orders. But what we try to instill upon our officers and our sergeants is that although a lieutenant is the president, sergeants or the corporals when we had them still can provide the leadership, can provide the direction, and provide the necessary advice and stuff that we need to be successful. So that's the field marshal's baton based upon Rome, ends with Napoleon. But I think the saying of holding on the baton has been with us for a long, long, long time.
and I think it's, I just thought it was one of the best lessons that we had. This is supposed to be an iceberg. Those are penguins up there. Dad studied penguins. He liked penguins. He just thought they were cute. Penguins are very interesting call it animal, that they are very, very safe when they're on ice. You have no natural predators when they're on ice. Their natural predators are sharks or whales when they're in the water. To live and survive, penguins have to go into the water. That's what they eat. They feed off little small fish, items inside the water. They have nothing to eat when they're outside. So they have to go in the water. When they go in the water, there's so many of them, they swim, they naturally attract their natural predators. Predators will come. Most of the time, it could be shark or whale, and what they want to do is eat the penguins. Survival. That's nature. That's what happens. So when the penguins are in the water, and they sense danger, and they sense their predators nearing them, they will quickly get out of the water as fast as they can. And if they can get out fast enough, then they survive. Because there's no natural predator for them when they're outside the ice. The problem is after a while, they get hungry. They have to eat. And they have to go back in. At some point, they have to go back in. And there is the phrase, first penguin in. The first penguin in. One of these penguins has to jump in the water. One of them has to go in, one of them has to dive in, go all in, to see if it's safe. My dad always believed that he would say that. Sometimes you just have to be the first penguin to jump. Sometimes you just have to be the one that goes out there and you got to test it. And so what happens is, they jump in, they swim, they look, and the rest of the penguins kind of sit up here and they look down. Joe comes back up, must be good. If he doesn't come back up, well, we better wait a little bit longer. That's the whole thing. So there's risk. There's tremendous risk sometimes when you jump off the edge. You have to stop in. But is it necessary in what we do? Yeah. Is there risk taking in everything that we do? Are there times sometimes where you have to be the one that just kind of steps out there a little bit? And you have to lead and you have to make a decision and you have to do something out of your comfort zone? Perhaps there's a little bit of danger. Perhaps somebody is going to criticize you for the decision that you just made. Somebody might not like it. But in the world in which we live, especially now, especially the way things are right now, there always will be critics and supporters. And sometimes you just have to take the chance and you have to go out and you have to make some of these decisions and you have to be the first penguin to jump into that water. And obviously, in the world in which we live, we do that quite often. Sometimes we get it right, and sometimes we don't. The good news for us, we don't get eaten, you know, that type of thing. But also sometimes you guess wrong, and your decision is probably not the best one. But sometimes you just have to take those chances. And so that's the first penguin in. Let's see. Chaos, chaos, chaos. I'll tell you why I like that. Is, you know, in my mind, and I'm sure you all know this, when you look at leadership, you also have to be a really good manager. Management, you know, is all about the managing of things, leadership is about people. In leadership positions, you create programs, you create projects, you build things, you do things, you implement strategies, and you do things. And the thing that I was always taught is try to create the chaos before you ever implement it. What I mean by that is, troubleshoot, troubleshoot, troubleshoot. Bring in people to second guess what you're doing. Ask questions of what you're doing. Ask how things are going to work, the what ifs, before you ever implement a program. Try to figure out all the bad things that could happen before they happen, and how are you going to fix them? Things that you need to do to implement these things. Put it all up in front. Figure out what can go wrong with these things. Figure out how you're going to deal with it before you ever implement it. Because once you implement it, sometimes you can't go back. You've got it, you bought it, and you're going to have to figure out how to make this thing work. And we've had some of those examples. The good news for us, most of the time we have figured it out, and we move on. Well, what we do now is when we start to implement things, we make sure the best that we possibly can is that what we're doing is the right thing, and we've covered all the bases before we go on. This one right here, this is interesting. This is really kind of interesting.
cutting the red tape. Anybody work for a governmental agency? Are we criticized sometimes for being in a bureaucracy? You know, people think that, you know, called and get put off and all that sort of thing. I was in Louisville yesterday. My son wanted a baseball bat from the Louisville Spectrum. Doesn't even play baseball. I don't even know why you needed it. So I ran over there before I was going to speak, and I bought this bat. They said, you know, you can't take that on the plane. And, you know, you'll have to book it and all that kind of stuff. I said, okay, well, we can mail it to you. I said, good, I'll take the mail. Okay. Now, this is 5 minutes to 5. They close at 5 o'clock. And so I paid my $70, $10 for the mailing. And they were going to mail this thing off. And, okay, thank you very much. And so I do all my stuff and that leaves. And as I started to walk back, I realized on the receipt it says, allow 15 working days for delivery. Birthday parties, Saturday. Okay, so I thought, okay, that's not going to work. Of course, I run back and it's closed. Because I was the last one that closed at 5 o'clock. So the next morning, I run back the 7 blocks and I get there. Now, this is about a quarter after 8. Remember, they closed at 5 o'clock the night before. This is a quarter after 8 the very next day. And I said, hey, I was here yesterday. I bought this bat. I was going to mail it. I would like to just pick it up and take it back. Oh, you can't do that. And I said, why? He says, because you ordered it, and now they have to make it at the factory. I said, well, don't you make them like right here? He says, yeah, that's if you want to take it with you. And I said, well, can you like cancel that one, and I'll just take one from right here? No, we can't do that. And I said, well, why not? He says, because we don't do that. And I said, could you do that? No. And so I said, please, birthday party. Well, let me talk to my manager. So he runs off, talks to the manager, and all said and done, I finally get it done. And they gave me the bat and the whole thing. But the system is set up as a bureaucracy. You cannot talk to the clerk, you cannot talk to a manager, you cannot change your mind because this order has already been out there, and I'm really talking about 5 minutes of work time. And the answer was no, but I eventually got it. That's what we get accused of all the time. Mm-hmm. We get accused of that. We get accused of the red tape. Well, interesting thing about red tape, and I found this really, really interesting. It's, you know, after the Civil War was over, you know, the North and the South that fought. Very, very, very bloody, very ugly war. And when the war was over, the North wanted to pay back monies to some of the ranchers and people living in the South. Some of the properties that were destroyed and confiscated when the North moved into some of the homes. And Washington decided to pay back some money, which is good. They were going to pay back for some of the properties that were seized. What was the good news? The bad news was, in order to get the money, you had to go to Washington, D.C. Okay, so you think about it. You're in Tennessee. You're in Kentucky. Okay, you're in the Deep South, and you need to go get your $100. You have to go to Washington, D.C. And if you could make it, if you got there, you gave the money to you in cash and it was wrapped in red tape. Okay? A red tape run. Ever heard red tape before? Red tape, well, that's where it comes from. Comes from that, comes to the bureaucracy, comes to unnecessary involvement or risk or uncomfortable discovery, you know, whatever you want to put word you put up. So every time I hear red tape, I think about that. Think about somebody, 1865, 1866, has to get on a horse, ride 700 miles to go get $100, and you get there, and it's wrapped in tape. And so in your own organization, you have to think about that. Where do I have red tape? Where do I do that? Where is it that I am not providing service to the public? One of the biggest fights that I have in my organization, and I haven't won yet. You think I'm the commissioner of the hospital, I win all my battles with my own department. I'm working on it. I'm going to win. I do not like the fact that we still to this day have the answering machine that comes on. Your call is important to us. But not that important. I will get to you when I can get to you. And if you really, 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 really want me, push one. You know, if I can call you back later, push two, that whole thing. Not sure how we got that as a law enforcement agency, how we ended up with something like that, but we have it in our dispatch centers. I'm the commissioner of the Hive Trail. The commissioner of the Hive Trail. I'll call my number sometimes. I get that recording. And it's frustrating. And so I'm telling my commander, you gotta get rid of that thing. answer the phone, say hello. Can I help you? And can we do something for you and stuff? And I think that's one of the things we have to do. We have been conditioned sometimes for efficiency. And with that efficiency become lack of effectiveness in dealing with people. Because people are not machines, they're not. They call you because there's a problem. They call you because there's an issue. And they want to talk to somebody. And in our old system, we don't allow that to happen unless you stay on the line forever and somebody decides they want to talk to you. And I think that's important that we recognize that and figure out a better way to go about it. And that's just one example. But you have to look at your own department, your own discipline, your own way you do things, even internal. How do you deal with things and how do you get out of your silo to understand the person in the next one? And you work to each other, not creating the red tape. So, trust me, we have it within our organization. We're trying hard to get rid of that. We're trying to figure out how we can be a more innovative, more accessible organization to the public. There are some limitations on what we can do, but we certainly don't have all the answers. I think my friends from DMV, you guys are way ahead of me with your advance, and I mean this sincerely, with your advancements in technology, in the way you have streamlined and allowed the public to go into a DMV office or not go into a DMV office to have service. Because you think about it, and I hope you don't mind just a little bit, if you think about it, who used to get the brunt of the jokes for bureaucracy? You guys do. You don't hear that anymore. You really don't hear it. I mean, what you've done is just fascinating. It's absolutely fascinating for all of you that if you haven't experienced the new way to go register your car, get your driver's license, and all that sort of thing. Fascinating. You know, and we're behind you. And we're trying to catch up and we're trying to do things and we're trying to figure out how we get rid of that red tape and we make our organization a little bit more easy to work through and be able to get some things done. This is important for us, understanding both sides of the issue. When we were young and we were asked our opinion to do things, or my dad would want to have discussions with us, my dad always made us argue the other side, no matter what it was. You know, we wanted to go to Disneyland, and my other brother wanted to go to a Niner game. My dad would make me see it from my brother's side, and he'd have to understand it from my side. He'd make us debate both sides. And he taught us to understand that, you know, you have conviction in what you want to do, you have appreciation of what you want to do, and you have a desire to do what you want to do. But what does the other guy say? What does the other person say? Do you truly hear what they're talking about? Do you understand it? Do you understand that, you know, there is two sides, or maybe three sides, or four sides to every issue? You're pushing your issue, but turn it around and jump into the other shoes and argue from their standpoint. See what you learn. See if it changes your perspective. Maybe it does, maybe it doesn't. At least you understand why somebody disagrees with you, why they're challenging some of the things you said, why they challenge the assumptions that you have made. And then maybe, who knows? Maybe you don't take the original side. Maybe you take the other side. Maybe you don't take either side and you come up with a new decision based upon the information that you have. And so what we have instilled in our organization, we have our executive staff. We meet every Monday morning. So you have the top four plus the two executives, top six people within my organization. We try to meet every Monday. And so you have all the issues that have occurred from the last week, all the things we want to do in the week. And trust me, at that level, you have some very diverse opinions. You have people who are dug in with tradition. You have people who want to be a little bit more, perhaps, innovative. And so a topic will go out on the table, and immediately somebody will jump in, we need to do this. And so we let talk, we go, and somebody this and this and that, and they always know what's going to come. And we flip it, and we talk about it the other way. And I'll tell you where I learned my best lesson for me, is when I was going to command college. To get into command college, you have to go to an assessment center. And when you go to the assessment center, you go in and you pull a topic out of a hat, and you're going to have to debate this topic. And so I went in there, and it was on the death penalty. And so they have you prepare for whatever side they give you. So they gave me the pro side.
So I have the pro side, and I'm trying to study and trying to do this whole thing, and right before you go in, yes, they switch it. They say, you're not the pro side, you're the against side. Okay, and you have to go and debate it. And then you have to see it from a totally different perspective in the way you go. And that was an eye-opener to me. It was a true eye-opener to me to understand a topic like that from both sides. Both sides of the equation, to see how much emotion goes into that, and how if you are asked to argue a point, how sometimes you can actually not talk yourself into something, but talk you to a point where you truly understand the other side. You truly understand what is actually being debated and what the true issue is versus something that is very emotional. And you've chosen to go a certain way because of the emotions, not because of the fact, but because of the emotions. And so if you ever get in, especially if you have staff and you have people, take any topic that comes in. And especially, I'll tell you what the most difficult for us is, and it's the job, part of the job I don't like, as the appointing authority, and I have the responsibility to hire people, and I have the responsibility to discipline people. One of the things I hate to do more than anything is misunderstanding in state government and human behavior. People will do things that they shouldn't. People will get themselves into trouble. And sometimes they're written reprimands, sometimes they get days off without pay, but ultimately sometimes you have to make a decision where if you're going to fire somebody. You're actually going to fire somebody. So when the internal affairs comes in to brief the cases with me, the way we do it is, I'll be here, I'll have my command staff, then I have internal affairs comes in, and then I have my prosecuting attorneys who will come and actually try the case. And they have to present the case on what they believe the penalty should be. And they always know what happens. They have to flip it around, they have to argue the other side on why I shouldn't fire. And those are some really, really good debates. And it allows me to understand what the real issue is, because you get to see both sides. It's a great practice that we have, and I think it's paid really good dividends for me, because it helps me see clearly what the true issue is, and you understand what the topic is, and how I mean the decisions that you can actually make. I like Mickey Mouse. I like Disneyland. I like the whole thing about that. So I put Mickey up there. Time is your ally. You know, it really is that it's your ally, and it's something there where a lot of times, you know, people in positions of responsibility rush to make decisions. They make decisions sometimes when, really, if they stop, think about it a little bit. For the most part, time is on your side. It really, truly is on your side where you can stop and you can look and you can think about things and make some informed decisions based upon your debate, based upon information that you have. And if you just slow things down, that's why a lot of people always, they'll come up and they go, God, you couldn't have your job, you know, you get 12,000 people, billions of dollars, let's drive you crazy, all these decisions you have to make. I don't have to make the same decisions as our officers do out on the street. I make decisions that are much more timely. I can debate issues. I can think about issues. I can spend some time to look further into issues, just as you can. Now, there are times that's not true. There are times, I think the whole idea is that you just have to recognize the times where you have to move quickly, you have to respond, and you have to make decisions. But also recognize when you don't. And that's something that comes. I mean, there are times where people will bring in things to me and they'll go, have you bought off on that yet? And I'll say, no. And they'll look at me like, it's been there for 3 days. And I always tell them, yeah, I don't know what to do yet. I haven't decided what I want to do on that yet. I'll get back to you when I do. Knowing that time is really on my side. And I think the trick on that slide, the trick there is to recognize when it's your ally and to recognize when it's not. And knowing when you have to do something right then and there versus go. And the trick is, when you have to do something then, immediately, most of the time you have to recognize that you probably won't have all the information that you need to make that decision. And I think most schools will teach you that good decisions can sometimes be made with 60 to 70% of information. In the world of law enforcement, supervision on the streets, we're out there doing jobs. If you wait too long, and time is not your ally, then the decisions you make are made too late. And there's an old saying out there that the greatest decision made too late is worthless. It serves no purpose. You know, so a mediocre decision made on time
is a heck of a lot better than the greatest decision made too late. Recognize when you have to act and when you have to make a decision versus the times when you can slow everything down, step away from something, and make a decision based upon more information, more time, less emotion, and understand the difference. The Road to Abilene. You know, some of you probably going to school here probably read the book by Jerry Harvey, The Abilene Paradox. It's an interesting book, isn't it? It's a good book, you know, and it's my dad used to talk about how people get talked into things, how you are just kind of along for the ride, and then for those of you that haven't read the book or really truly really understand it, I'll try to capsulize it in just a nutshell. It talks about, you know, it tries to illustrate how people can get talked into just about anything. And the illustration in this book are a couple of three guys. They're sitting around in the hot summer of Texas. They're sitting at a guy's house, and they really don't know what to do. They don't want to know what to do on this Friday night. They're actually very comfortable. They're relaxing. They're sitting in rocking chairs. They're having an adult beverage. It's nice, cold, spiked lemonade. And they're just taking in the world, enjoying each other's friendship. They're joking. They're talking about things. But they really don't know what they're going to do for the day. And one of them says, well, what do you guys want to do? I don't know. What do you want to do? Oh, it doesn't matter to me. I'll do anything. Oh, I don't know. What do you want to do?
Doesn't matter.
Well, you could go to Abilene. I'll go to Abilene if you want to go to Abilene. Well, you know, we could go there. What do you think? Oh, I'll go. Okay. So we'll go. So they get in this car and they drive. They have no air conditioner. They're in this truck going down this dirt road. Dirt flying all over the place. They can't drink. They're hot. They're stinky. Sweaty. They get into this town and they have a miserable time. Absolutely miserable time. And on the way back, they're driving back, they said, well, that was a really good idea, Randy. Why did we go to Abilene? Go, I didn't want to go to Abilene. You mentioned it. I said, I never wanted to go. You said, so I didn't say that. I just said we could go. And no, you said, do you want to go? I said, no, we could go. You said, let's go. And then you said you would go if he wanted to go. Well, none of them ever wanted to go.
Yeah.
And they had an absolutely miserable time. It's the Road to Abilene. How many times has it happened in organizations where you sit around and people start talking? Somebody at that point just said, guys, we're sitting here at home. We got the cooler right here. We got things going on. The big game's coming on in a minute. We're sitting out here in a rocking chair. Who wants to go to Abilene? It's 50 miles away on a dirt road. Da, da, da. That's crazy. Let's just stay right here. And that's the Abilene paradox, is about how we, if we're not careful sometimes, these leaderless groups, the leaderless discussion will take over. And people will just move with the group, not based upon or any meaningful dialogue. The group just moves. And sometimes you realize that's not where you wanted to go. And then when you look back, everybody's going, how did we get here? How did we get to this point? How did we implement this program? And you look around and there's nobody taking ownership. The system just kind of moved it on its own. And if you're not careful, you know, it can happen in our own. I don't think we drive to Abilene. But we end up doing things that we ordinarily, that's probably not a good idea. Probably shouldn't have tried that. I should be doing it different. Then you try to figure out, who am I supposed to blame? Well, who to blame? It's the group. The group just kind of moves with it. So it's a very interesting book if you ever get a chance to read it. It probably explains it a lot better than I did. But I think it was pretty important. I don't know if I have two slides here or not. This one was, this is my dad's philosophy. He told me that I'll tell you the story, is that when I was a young boy, I tried out for the Little League team, and it was for 9-year-olds to 12-year-olds, and I was 9 years old. And so I tried out, and I didn't make it. Okay, so what they do back then, you know, everybody lines up, and then the coaches pick the players and all that sort of thing, and so they picked everybody, and I was the last guy standing. Okay, no team. All the teams were full, and there was no team for me. And very devastating as a 9-year-old boy. And so I went home. I was crying. I was all upset. And my dad said, well, you know, baseball is baseball, but you're probably not going to play baseball for your entire life. He says, I'll teach you a game. You will play it for the rest of your life, and that you will enjoy it for the rest of your life, and it's golf. So he taught me how to play golf. And
golf has been a sport that I've played my entire life and taught my family to play, and he was right. But he also told me at the same time, he says, Joe, you're going through a lot of adversity right now. And he says, the interesting thing, the thing that you need to know when you face adversity, always remember, you'll learn two things when you face adversity, two things. They're both very, very powerful lessons. First one is about yourself, about who are you, what are you made of, what can you really do, and how are you going to rebound? What are you going to do, and how are you going to make a difference in the adversity that you're facing? What are you going to do? And how are you going to stand up to the adversity? Are you going to face it head on? Are you going to stand there, pout, and cry because you didn't make it you needed to? Who are you? Who is Joe Farrow, and what is Joe Farrow going to do? He says the second lesson, though, is more important, Joe. He says it's about who you surround yourself with, who your supporters are, who your mentors are. Who are the people who care about you? Who are the people who are going to respond to you because you didn't make this team? They're going to help you and motivate you and try to get you ready for the next time. Versus, who are the people making fun of you? Who are the people who bully you? Who are the people saying you're no good? You'll never be any good. You cannot play baseball. Remember that. Remember the lessons that are given to you when you face adversity. One about you and one about your colleagues and your friends. You will all face adversity in your life. You will. You will face adversity personally and professionally. And you will get through it with the skills that you have. And part of it is recognizing how good you really are and how you can attack and how you can deal with things even when you think they're the most difficult times. You can deal with this. You've been trained, you've been educated, you've been motivated, and you can take things on. But also remember, when you are facing that adversity, who are your true friends? Who are the people who surround themselves with you and say, you know, let me help you. I can help you with this. Let's put our heads together. Let's figure out how you can get through this. Or I'm a phone call away if you need me. If you need me, call me. And who is that person? And what you realize sometimes is people that you really thought were your friends, they're not. That's what this was all about with my father. Is he says, understand who your true supporters are in your organization. Know who they are. Know the people who are loyal to you, know the people who have your back, know the people who truly care about you, and are there for you to help you, be successful. And when you learn that lesson and you know who those people are, then you've got it. Because that whole thing was about there are postures of this world. There are people who are convenience, co-workers and friends, and there are people who are truly, truly, truly at your back and at your side. And recognize who they are and surround yourself with people like that. So those are the two lessons of adversity. Organizational communication. This is kind of a no-brainer, but I think it's important just to talk about. Communication in the network in your organization is probably the most important thing you do. When you lead organizations, a lot of your communication goes down. It goes downwards to the employees within the organization. There probably is a system where it comes back up. So your rank and file can get information to you. A lot of lateral that goes between us, goes between each other. But the most powerful, the most persistent, and sometimes the best and the worst is the informal, which is the rumors. The rumor mill within the organization are live and well. Alive and well in the organization are the things that get out into the system that may be true, they may be false. They may be embellished, they may be understated. That communication process is always going, and it never stops. Although you're not talking and giving a message to the people that you work with, and you're not hearing things back the other way, the system is working. The system develops its own communication, develops its own thoughts, it develops its own, and I don't mean in a bad way when I say rumors. I don't mean every rumor is bad. When people will hear things, they'll talk, they'll develop their own story that will get out into the system that unknowing people will think is the truth, they'll think it's the new policy, they'll think it's the new rule. I cannot tell you how many times that I have traveled. I'll go into a command that is far away from places I've never been before, and we'll sit down, we'll start talking, somebody will raise their hand, and somebody will say, Commissioner, we heard that you want to do this. I go, who told you that? That's the stupidest thing I've ever heard of. I don't know. I would never want to. Well, you know, I had it from a good source that I don't know who the good source is. I don't know where those stories come from. I don't know who tells people certain things. But that is alive and well in your system, and it's always out there.
And so in a good organization, especially in a state agency where you have the entire state that you deal with, you have to figure out how you're going to communicate with everybody. And you have to figure out how you're going to allow the system to communicate with you. And so you can make sure that everybody understands what's going on. And keep that lateral communication going, because if you're not saying anything and nothing's coming back your way, just don't think that the system is shut off. It is alive, it's running, it runs 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and it never shuts down. And somebody is feeding into that information all the time. Your job is to understand where it comes from, how it works, and how you are going to deliver your message so people truly understand what you're trying to do and how you're trying to do it. Me, mine, I try to get the message out the best I can. Every single year, I write a commissioner's guide to all of my commanders and my employees. It's about a 15 to 18 page document, big bold letters and blocks. I talk about my vision. I talk about the vision of the hive patrol. I talk about my expectations. I talk about what is important on the hive patrol. What is important to this administration? What is important to the people of California? And how are we going to deliver that? And how are we going to implement things and go from there? Based upon that document, that's what we build our strategic plan off. That's what we build all of our examinations off for promotion. It's what we build all of our lateral transfers for people who want command positions or transferring. It's all based upon their knowledge of what the vision is, our strategic plan, how we're going to go about it, and what we're going to try to accomplish over the next 5 years. So there is no misunderstanding of what is important and what is not important. There is an expectation that all the managers on the Highway Patrol will understand what's in that document, how it was made, why it was made, and what their role in the implementation is. It's very, very important to do that. That's how I communicate with a lot of my commanders, and I think that would be really important. But on this one right here, I'm sure you know what I'm talking about. The rumor mill system in your organization is out there. It can be very destructive if left alone, but it's also at the same time just understand it's there. You can use it to your advantage too, but just put something into the system that you want delivered. It'll get out there for you real quick. along with that line right here is, are those microphones in the makeup? I think they are. It's always on. You are always on. Curtain is always open. You're always on display. Everything you do is heard by everybody. Every movement you make, everything you do, every smile, every frown, every time you get angry, every time you get happy, is interpreted, received, acknowledged, watched by everybody in your organization. There are no private moments when you work. You're always, always on stage. I don't mean that bad. I'm just saying that you are. And so people know when you're angry. They know when you're happy. And they know when there's things on your mind, they know when you're distant, and they watch you. And so the whole thing goes is that when you're angry, you have to recognize it. Know when you do that. You ever seen one of those emails that go out and blast somebody? And you go, God, who sent that? And you think, how mad were they for that to go out? And when you finally talk to somebody, you say, did you really send this thing out? He goes, oh, man, I was so mad. You hit send and it's gone. It's gone forever. You never can take it back. You say something to somebody, that anger, hard to take it back. You hurt somebody's feelings, and they remember that for a long time. You're frustrated. You're not on cue. You're not your normal self when you're frustrated or you're down. You just have to recognize that. And so one of the things that I've tried to do, and I've been angry before. Probably have said some things sometimes I probably shouldn't have. But I really, really pride myself on one thing now, is that I never, ever try to be in a position where I'm angry about people. And there are things, trust me, that can disappoint you. You get mad. You cannot make decisions when you're angry. You should not make decisions when you're angry. You have to figure out how you can decompress, you can take a deep breath. Remember I told you, time is on your side a lot of times. You just get up, you walk away, you cool off, you figure out what you want to do, take a deep breath, you come back, you sit down, and you deal with the issue at hand. It's always on. And people are always perceiving everything that you do. The curtain never closes. Disney has the greatest thing on them.
go to Disney, if you go to Disney University, they talk about going on stage is when cast members enter the environment of what they have to be, they play a role. And they teach every member that when you're playing a role, you are actually part of the cast. You can never walk away from that role, ever. Because if the public sees you not in the role but in the costume, they don't know how to interpret that, and the kids might go, oh my God, there's Mickey Mouse with no hat on. And stuff. So they always try to make sure that people always remember that they're part of the cast. You as the leadership, I don't use the word cast to mean what your role is. But to a lot of people, the curtain is open and they watch it. They watch everything that you do. And you know that whole thing about what do you do, not what you say? That's what that slide is all about. It goes right along with communication. Every friend has a friend. And the thing about that is that you are entrusted with a lot of information. You have to make a lot of decisions. You have to talk about a lot of things. A lot of things that you do are confidential. That's why they're very nature. They're extremely confidential. Some things are illegal for you to talk about in public. Illegal for you to go out and talk about somebody, you know, about their health, their medical, or anything. It's illegal. So be very, very, very careful when you share things with people. Because I think you know that everybody has a friend. So you tell somebody in confidence, hey, let me tell you something. Real secret. Wait till you hear this. What do you think? What do you really think is going to happen with that information? What do you think? Okay. This other person's going to go, hey, guess what the commissioner just told me? Oh, you have to believe this. He's got a friend. Oh, man, guess what Jeff said? The commissioner said that. And then what happens is, by the time the story goes around, I may have said, hey, I think it's going to rain tomorrow. By the time it gets through the whole thing, hey, the commissioner, oh, man, he says that tomorrow there's going to be a flash flood, people are going to die, da-da-da-da-da-da. And you don't even recognize what happened. Sometimes you want to talk to people, you want to share things with people, you want a second opinion and all that, but recognize the things that are confidential that you cannot talk about. You cannot talk about. Certain information that comes in sometimes, like, well, this word has to stop. It has to stop. It stops right there. And I have people I work for. I have people that I probably need to talk to. But I cannot share certain information that comes in, or I violate the trust, I violate the oath. This one's important for you to remember that there are things that you can't talk about, things you should not. But remember the things that you say in confidence. Recognize the fact that most of the time it's probably going to be shared. Maybe not. But understand human nature. People sometimes. And I don't mean that in a real bad way, it just means sometimes people will share the story. You just have to understand what you can and cannot talk about, because some things will get you in trouble. I tell this to all my cadets, many defenses. When you put 250 people into dorm room environments and you keep them in there for 6 months and you work them from 4 o'clock in the morning to 10 o'clock at night, very high stress, very high pressure. A lot of things happen. People become colleagues and friends, and some people become distant and angry at each other because of the inherent competition that has. But even in your own organizations, anybody have anybody, know anybody where somebody doesn't like somebody else? Employee A won't talk to employee B, or something like that. Unfortunately, you know, it happens. People get angry. A lot of times it's a misunderstanding. You know, a lot of times that people just fail to communicate, they don't even know why they're mad at each other. Kind of mend these that every chance that you get. And this always happens at our academy. So the thing I always make graduating cadets do, the last day I go out there before they graduate, I talk about mending the fences. I tell people that I know there are people in here that don't see eye to eye with one another. You know who you are, you know who the other person is. You will mend the fences. You will go over and you will talk to people. Try to bury the axe, because when you become part of this team, part of this organization, you're very dependent upon one another to be very successful. In a law enforcement world, that dependency can become life and death. Because when you go out and you work the road, you get out into the bad situation, the person that you have the broken fence with could be the person coming to back you up. And you want to make sure that you have an understanding and appreciation. You don't have to have bitter at each other's house, but
you should have an admiration and respect for one to understand that human nature, human contact, conflict does occur. It does. Figure out how to fix it. Figure out how to sit down with people and just say, hey, look, we got off the bat sort of, whatever it may be, fix it if you possibly can, because there's just too much of that distrust and anger sometimes in these organizations, and I think they're very, very destructive for a lot of people. Practice does not make you perfect. We are the California Highway Patrol. We are not a perfect organization. We're not. We try hard. We try to be transparent. We try to deliver a product. We try to make people in California safe. We try to follow all the rules and SAM manual and everything we possibly can. We try really, 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 really hard. We don't have anybody in the organization that wakes up in the morning and goes, you know what, I'm just going to go screw everything up. I'm going to do everything I can to make everybody's life miserable and just violate all the policies. It normally doesn't happen. But we do make mistakes. We've been audited and people have come in and says, hey, you know, you guys are doing this, this, and this. You can't do this. We get beat up, we correct it, and we try to do better. We practice, and we train, but we're not perfect. And sometimes, you know, I'll deal with the media, and the media will call me and go, how do you guys mess this thing up? How did you do this? Or what were you guys thinking? And that's what I was telling them. I said, let me try hard. Try hard. This wasn't our best effort. It wasn't our best effort. We tried to do the best that we possibly could. Give us another chance to regain your trust. We'll try really, really hard. And that's all you can do sometimes, is to do the best that you possibly can and understand that you can practice all day long and will not be. I always liked it. Look at the analogy of baseball. They were talking about the Hall of Fame. You get in the Hall of Fame, you got a bad lifetime over 300. For you non-baseball fans, so every 100 times you get up to the plate, you got to hit 30 balls. Okay? That means you get to make 70 outs. 70 outs, 30 hits, Hall of Fame. You guys practice every day. Every single day, batting at 30%. 30% is what they do. And they're the best in the world. And in your line of work, that's what you do. You train, you develop, you try to get people focused, you try to get them to do the right thing, you try to train them, go on and just understand that your system isn't perfect. It'll probably never be perfect. You still strive for it. But I'm not sure that a perfect organization truly exists out there. And if there are things that you have to constantly monitor and watch and just understand, that to try as you might, you may not always get everything. My 3 D's, this is for the management side of the house. Let's see where I'm at. A little bit behind. Do, drop, and delegate. Okay, it's very, very simple. 3 D's. What are the things you have to do? What do you do that only you can do? What are the things that you can drop? You don't have to do them. Nice to do. Nice to go to Louisville, Kentucky and talk. Nice to come down to USC and talk. Absolutely have to do it? Probably not. But nice thing to do? Yeah. What can I delegate? What has to be done? What can be done by somebody else? That's your time management. That's the critical part about you, is understanding what you have to do that has to be done. Understand the things that you want to do. You may not have to. And understand the things that you can delegate down. It's very simple. 3 D's. And you'll know the answer to those. And that's the world. For all you execs in here, for all of you that are leading people, you probably live in the same world that I do. Things that you have to do, things that you want to do. And they conflict with each other all the time. And you have to balance out how do you do that. So on the do list, what can you delegate down so you have more time to do the things that you want to do? Got to find that time, because you only have so many hours in the day. You have to figure out how you're going to do that. And this is where it all started for me. This is lesson number 18. This is the one that is most important to me. This is my dad's philosophy of life and leadership. It's very simple. ABC. And the A, back then, I was learning how to play golf. Played in a high school golf tournament one time, and I didn't play very well. And just like a
a lot of 16-year-old kids, their emotions get to you, and I broke a golf club, and I cursed them. And my dad saw me do that. So he suspended me from playing golf for 3 days. Couldn't play golf. And he told me that my attitude absolutely stunk, that I wasn't worthy to play golf, and that I embarrassed him, and I embarrassed the family. And that's when he sat me down and talked about ABCs of life. And he told me, he says, Joe, remember in life that people rally behind people with good attitudes, with positive attitudes, with together attitudes, collaborative attitudes, winning attitudes. That's why the A stands for attitude. It's all about your attitude. It's all about the way you take on life and the way you understand things. People don't want to be around. People are negative all the time. It's always somebody else's fault. I just had this, I just had that. Or why did that putt go in? Why? He said, people just don't want to be around that. They want to be around inspirational people. Good attitudes, positive attitudes, winning attitudes, we're together attitudes. He said, it'll be inspiring. It'll be, people will come to you, they'll want to be around you. Nobody wants to be around somebody all mad all the time, blaming the world about everything. Nobody wants to do that. He says, nobody cared about you when you broke your golf club and threw it against the tree. You think you could, nobody wants that. They want to be around people that have good, positive attitudes, the people in your organization. They follow you because they believe in you. They believe in you because you instill confidence, winning attitude, and together we can do great things attitude. That's why people work for you. That's why the A becomes so important, that it should always be your guideline, no matter what happens. Remember I told you the stage is open, the microphone's on? Positive attitude. Do the best that you possibly can so people stay true and inspired to you. The B stood for balance. You know, balance in your perspective. Balance in your life. All work, no play, that doesn't work. All play, no work, that doesn't. You got to balance the two. You got to balance your perspective. It's not always hot, not always cold. How do you figure out where it is? Are you absolutely right and he's absolutely wrong? Can we agree to disagree, maybe find the middle ground, find that balance ground so we can kind of coexist and figure out together what we're going to do? I mean, the balance part is the part that you can't become so anal and so focused and concentrated on one thing that you're out of whack with everything else. One of the biggest things that happens to young police officers, they get hired and they're so energetic and they're so excited about their job that it's 90% job, it's 10% family. And that's why in law enforcement sometimes you see a high number of divorces, marriages that fail because the balance is off. Everything is work, everything is about, everybody's a bad guy. Everything is over here, and there's not enough of the family side on the other side. And so we tell our cadets, we tell our officers, you must make a balance in your life. You have to be able to do both, or three things, or four things, whatever. It cannot be all of one and nothing of the other. And you have to keep that harmony, and you have to be able to keep that perspective. The C was about choices. I don't think it was my dad made this up. I don't know where he heard it from, but he told me. He says that all of us are given two lives. Two lives. One that you learn with and one that you live with. He says it's all based upon choices. Choices that you make. Some are real easy. They're really easy choices to make. What to eat, what to wear a tie, not to wear a tie. Those are easy choices. There are some very difficult choices that have to be made that you have to really weigh into to decide what you want to do and not do. And those choices are really important, both in your personal life and in your professional life. The decisions that you make are extremely critical to the success of your organization and you and your personal life. And he says that understand that when you're making those type of choices, that you truly weigh the pros and cons about what you want to do. Back to where we went for that decision. What am I about to do? Is this good or is this destructive? Do I really need to do this at this time? Do I need to buy this boat at this time? Do I need to do this? Do I need to do that? And what do I really want to do? And what are the choices that I have in front of me? And then make sure that you understand when you make those, you have to live by it. And so that has been my guiding principle since I was just a young boy.
I teach it to all my cadets, I teach it to all my managers, I teach it to the organization. Attitude, balance, and choice. Good attitude, good balance in your life, make good choices. And most of the time, it will lead to success. And so that are my 18 lessons of leadership. They're very, very simple. They're not out of academic books and stuff. It's given to my father, who was a career military. Went to work for Pebble Beach Corporation in the 1970s and 80s. Rose to a very high level of trying to help run that organization. And the secret about my dad, which I just admired, he grew up in Georgia during the Depression. Never had the opportunity to go to college, never graduated in high school. Okay? He entered life with a sixth grade education. That's as far as he ever got. Those were his philosophies. That's how he was raised.